Hello, Facebook Live. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 270. The very first Emcomm Extra. I've been threatening to do this for some time. And Hurricane Matthew is on the way. Got a picture of that. Yeah, that's what it sort of looks like right now. It's just about to start beating heavily into Florida as we record this. And I couldn't get anybody from the Florida section, from the Georgia section, from the South Carolina section. Couldn't get any of those ARL guys to talk to me. I'm changing glasses to get rid of the reflections here. They're all too busy with the hurricane. So I picked up a couple of other useless characters here. Introducing for the very first time on Ham Radio Now, on your left is Marty Sullaway, KC1, Chicken with Fries. Hey, Marty.
Hi, Gary. Great to be here.
And on the right is David Goldenberg, W0DHG. And David, you are an emergency coordinator for one of the dozens of sections in the Los Angeles area, right?
That's right. In the area's northwest area and the West Valley part of the Northwest. So there are, yeah, lots of dozens of parts of the LA.
So it's about section. It's a couple of hundred feet wide.
Yeah. No, I have, I don't know, 10 miles by 10 miles or something like that.
Okay. So you are an Emcomm expert because you're an EC. Uh-oh. Did he freeze?
Yeah.
He froze. We'll see if he comes back. Marty, you are not an Emcomm expert.
I am not an Emcomm expert.
I've just been wanting to get you on the show. And
I've done Emcomm steps, but I'm not an Emcomm expert.
Yeah. But I wanted to get you on the show. And what I really want to do is make you not the youth correspondent, just a ham who happens to be pretty
young. The crazy ham from New England.
Oh, you got better earphones than me, too. Okay, so let me see if I can get David back.
This green screen is working well.
Yeah, yeah, it's fine.
Sorry, guys.
Yeah, you're back. At least.
Okay, I'm back.
Yeah. Yay. And so it would. The goal of this program is to just. It's a BS. It's a bull session about Emcomm and stuff. Because there's this hurricane coming on Florida that none of us know that much about what the hams are doing because they're not talking to me. they're out there somewhere.
They're busy, saving lives.
Busy with the hurricane. I do have in the background, I've got...
I've seen a lot of them while I'm deer hunting.
That, in theory, is the Florida emergency frequency. You guys hearing that okay?
Around here,
yep.
But. Yep.
Any other time you drive by these old cotton fields.
Sounds like rag chew.
Yeah, does that sound like Emcomm to you?
Nope.
He'll be out there digging up the, whole field.
Okay.
I hear them here.
Oh, yeah. It's 80 meters.
Yeah.
So here's the deal. I guess this will be the first subject that we can kick around. They ran a net at 7:30, about an hour before we got started here. And it was the ordinary Florida traffic net. And this frequency has been published by ARL. So this is the one of the announcements from ARL on their website. And they're saying that the Northern Florida Aries net under HF net manager Don Duckett and 9MN has been called up on 3950 or 7252, depending on propagation. Starting at 1300 UTC, which is going to be a bunch earlier today, because you know this is what's going on. It's banging Florida right now, and I guess the Northern Florida Aries group is because they got multiple sections down there, so they're the folks that are going to be running things. This net is for life safety communications, and that's according to ARRL Northern Florida Section Manager Steve Zabo, WB4OMM, one of the guys I tried to get on the show, but they're all pretty much too busy. This net is not for collecting weather data, idle conversations,
that live over on the coast of Georgia,
or chit-chat.
They've done evacuated
and Zabo call for operators outside the northern Florida or southern Florida sections who have good solid access to HF to, well, they want them to contact Don Duckett with their availability to be net control. Because, you know, I guess it gets dicey trying to be net control when there's a hurricane going over your head. So sometimes it'd be good to have somebody outside. Got to blink, David. Otherwise, I think you've frozen again. There you
go. Oh, sorry.
You're still
good. I'm still here. Yeah, it was probably 80 meters was probably a little early for that in the afternoon.
Well, it, around here, it's 9 o'clock p.m., so it's dark.
So is the idea that this is coming from somebody who doesn't know a lot about this stuff, is the idea that they're on 40 during the day, and then as soon as 40 goes long, they go to 80, so...
Yeah, Marty, your picture has frozen. I don't know if that's going to come back, but your sound is still there. There you go. You're back.
Is my picture back?
Yeah. Well, that's a good question. But let me get to what I was going to introduce first after this net finished. But while this net was going on, the net control came on and said, you know, I understand the frequency is supposed to be reserved for emergency communications, but there was nothing going on when the net control came on. In fact, he first came on and said, is this frequency in use? And gave his call sign. And a guy came back and said, the frequency is reserved for emergency communications. And he said, I'm the net manager. I'm just trying to figure out if the frequency is busy, I'm going to run a net. But it wasn't the Emcomm net. It was just the ordinary traffic net for the Florida, northern Florida section. And so he said, you know, I understand that it's supposed to be Emcomm, but I don't hear anything. So let's start the regular net and we'll see if the Emcomm guys need it for something. In theory, you know, they're all under the same umbrella. And a couple of minutes into getting the net started, he got email, a text message, something from Don that said, run your regular net. And if we need it, we'll break in. So, that sounded like a good idea to me. They didn't have anything to do. So, after the net was over, these guys, where'd they go?
All right, I'm back. Roll back.
Perfect. So, they came on, and one of them said, not representing anybody in particular, he said, in his opinion, that it would be better to have the frequency in use for some rag chewing for some folks from some folks who were highly aware of the situation, so that when, and they're down here in the Southeast, they're spread from Florida up to Georgia, North Carolina. So they'd be able to hear any Emcomm that needs the frequency and they would be prepared to yield it right away. But if they weren't rag chewing on it, then probably someone else would start using it, maybe a little bit farther away and with less awareness of what's going on 39, was it 3950?
50.
You said, yeah, 3950. Right. Less awareness of what's going on and harder to get the frequency back. So what do you think? Is that a good plan? Should we, I mean, is rag chewing okay or does it grate on you?
What they're asking you is what do you
think? It's kind of hard to say it's hard to keep a net going if there's no traffic going on there and it's all quiet. So I could see that point, but on the other side too, you know, it's a net. You call your net and looking for traffic and it's going to go silent if there's nothing going on. It's a tough one. We have the same thing here. We'll jump on there and they'll say the same thing. Well, your net doesn't start till 9 o'clock. Okay. we'll get there when we get there.
Seems to me that silence is a problem. Just, you know, if it's just nobody's talking and the frequency is empty, nature and ham radio abhors an empty frequency on a band that's open.
Yeah, for sure. Somebody's going to want to get on there and use it. So, and that totally makes sense. And, you know, as long as they're ready to step in and work the net or work any traffic that comes up, it's good that they're there and they're willing to help out as opposed to someone who's going to say, yeah, we're talking and, you know, wait your turn.
Yeah. So with this hurricane going on, why isn't there traffic on the frequency with, actual activity? I think I got a radar here. We can watch this thing. Let me refresh it because it's a little old. I mean, here it comes. It's going to make landfall up in the Jacksonville area, a little bit south of Jacksonville. And I don't know, maybe this isn't quite bad enough yet. But where's the Emcomm traffic?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. You know, I thought about it when you sent the note out today. And, you know, in California, where we are, Los Angeles area, you know, we don't get a lot of notice of an earthquake or a fire or anything like that. And I know there was a big evacuation order in place. And, you know, one wonders in the first place, how many hams are still there if they've evacuated?
Yeah.
Right. I mean, if they said get out of town, you know, and, you know, here in Los Angeles, if they tell us to get out of town, we pretty much get out of town. You know, and if we're asked to, you know, go join our served agencies, then we'll go and help them out. But that's probably the first question I'd want to know, you know, asking where the nets are, is they may have all left.
That's a good point, because there has been call for evacuation all the way on the eastern Florida counties, although I'm not sure where those guys are going to go, because it's going to, you know, it's going to pretty much hit the whole state of Florida. This is big enough that it's even the western coast is going to get some of it.
Yeah, I think that what I heard was it was a coastal evacuation, so they're asking to move inland. But, you know, again, if you think about if the traffic's on 40 or 80 meters and you're used to working out of your house with a big antenna and you pick up and go, not everybody has a go kit that's going to be able to go and deploy 48 or meters. And again, if with the weather pattern that you're seeing there, how do you get an antenna up and how do you keep it up and how do you work that?
Yeah.
Especially 80 meters, getting any, if you're going to a shelter, to me at least, I think about going anywhere non ideal, being able to get even a low dipole on 80 meters is a big antenna.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's, I guess that could be why they're not there. Well, I guess the other thing is, other than reporting to the National Weather Service or to the National Hurricane Center, what is there to do before this thing actually hits? Our job comes afterwards, right?
Yeah, that's right. Or people are going to shelters now and doing their thing. And it's not now that people want to know that their families are safe in a shelter. It's going to be in 12 hours, 24 hours after it's kind of going through or hitting, that radiograms will start up and all the other stuff's going to start to happen, where people are going to really need to get reports in and out. It's probably a little premature right now.
Yeah, the storm isn't... It had been slated to go over my head in the early projections, and now it's going to curve rapidly out to the east. So it doesn't look like we're going to get hit real bad here in central North Carolina. So no evacuation. A little bit of our coastal counties, they're recommending some evacuation. But farther south, South Carolina and Georgia, they're all heading inland. They reversed the interstate that goes out of Charleston, South Carolina, toward Columbia. So all sides were going out. That's always been a controversial thing, but apparently it worked pretty well. Got a lot of people out of our old Charleston. Is this national news? Are you guys hearing lots about it? David, you're on the far west coast, where who could care less?
No, it's making the news here. It is definitely, you know, on the regular nightly news, and I heard it on the radio going in and out of work today. So it's making it here. It's important. You know, the other thing about nets is I wonder about Skywarn nets, probably somewhere else, not on that frequency. What's that?
I said I hear my local Skywarn is activating. Yeah, even up here, it's making the news.
Yeah, and I'd wonder where that net is. That's probably a much more active net at this time.
Right. Yeah, and I had dialed up Echolink, and I turned it off as I was trying to make everything work here. Let me see if I can tune into these guys. Okay. In theory, I'm connected. I'm just going to kind of leave them in the background. That's the Echolink thing is interesting. We'll see what kind of activity there is there.
That's the Echolink to WX4HC?
In theory, they're on it. Let's see.
I got the call sign right. Did I? No.
Trying to find the right button to bring this up. Well,
there you go.
Yeah,
There's people there.
It's called WX_talk on Echolink. And they say it's Skywarn and National Hurricane Center. And that's the National Hurricane Center may monitor it some, or someone may forward traffic from them off of there.
Okay. So I see on that list, KD1CY Rob, and he's actually the person who heads up our Skywarn, or partially. So I assume that, yeah, they must all be BC. That's National Weather Service Taunton, Massachusetts, where WX1BOX. So,
yeah.
Yeah. I think they're all just tied together.
And I don't see, oh, yeah, there's my call sign.
Yeah, you're on there.
Yeah. So a lot of people will be tuned in just to listen, let's get the right camera switched up there. I'll figure out what this camera thing is in a little while. But just before the show is over, I'll know what button to push before I push it.
Right. Well, of course.
So I'm going to leave them up kind of in the background, and we'll see if they pop up with some noise. So it's sounding a little bit quiet there, too. I didn't tune into the National Hurricane Center's HF frequency. They're on 7268 in the evening when 20 meters closes down. And for the region they're looking at, they really ought to be on 75 meters, I think. But maybe 40 is doing the job for them. Especially if they get a net control to help them out, a relay station that's out of town. So again, what we're saying is the activity now as this is coming ashore is reports to the Weather Service offices. And those are going to be on VHF and the Skywarn nets locally down there. We're not going to hear them.
Right. Yeah, that'll be local traffic primarily.
And this right. looks like it, you know, it's a category 4 at least, or you know, 3 at least, and maybe 4 as it's hitting the east coast of Florida. So it's going to be pretty bad.
It's real.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Yeah, go ahead, David.
Yeah, and I think to the traffic, to the reports you're going to have out of there, you know, give it 8 hours, 12 hours, wait until see what the morning looks like. I think that's what the kind of traffic that we'd have coming out of here after an event like an earthquake or the big fires, you know, everybody's kind of got to wait, see what happens. And then you pick up and you go look around outside and okay, this is that. And we have this problem and we need to respond to these areas. I think it's a little early to be hearing a lot of stuff, especially if it's not on CNN right now, right? It's just hitting land and it's going to be a while, but tomorrow will probably be when you really start hearing things.
CNN's not in all hurricane all day yet?
I don't know. I haven't looked yet, but I'll assume they're not there yet.
Yeah, I don't have CNN, so.
There's probably still more electoral news coming from them for the time being.
There's more money there.
Yeah, yeah. I guess.
Yeah, our local station, when a hurricane is closing in on the state, will do full-time all the broadcast stations, but they're not doing that up here. Now, I've been able to tune into TV stations on the web in Miami and Jacksonville, and they were all hurricane all the time. They have been all day, as you might expect. So,
I remember.
Go ahead.
Go.
Marty.
You go.
No, go ahead. Take it up, Marty.
Oh, sure. I remember when, what was it? Hurricane Sandy and Hurricane Irene, very, very small hurricanes, tiny hurricanes compared to what's hitting Florida now. Yeah, the news stations, everything, TV, radio, web, there was special web stations. And I wonder what is the level that causes CNN to switch over? Because it seems to me, and I'm the outsider on this one. It seems to me that this has the capacity to be a very big storm.
I think the touchstone was coming from the Echolink, so we know we're hearing it. Well, for Florida and then for the eastern parts of Georgia.
Maybe this is a David question or a you question, Gary. How does this compare on any magnitude to Katrina?
Katrina was Category 4 when it hit New Orleans, wasn't it?
Yeah, I believe so.
And this is Category 4.
Yeah.
Yeah, the problems in New Orleans were engineering problems, right? A lot of that city is below sea level. And, you know, you had a lot of failures of levees and dams and other stuff. And that exacerbated that. So hoping this one won't be as bad. I mean, it's going to hit, and it's going to hit hard, but a lot of that state is not like you saw in New Orleans.
Right. Yeah. And this map, that I'm showing here, they don't show it by category. They break it up into a little bit different system, but this M here, 110 miles an hour, and it's showing M all the way through Florida. And then H goes down to, 74 to 110. So I think the M is category 4 area. So yeah, that's true. Although, there's pretty much trouble with low lying areas all across the Florida coast.
Sure.
I understand that Miami is going to be mostly underwater in about 50 years.
Oh, wow.
But here's another thought, getting back to when we were talking about earlier about the Nats on 75. How much of this communication is really going to be over 2 meters and 440, and we will never hear it?
I'll go with a lot.
Yeah, right. I agree.
As long as the repeaters are up.
I agree. Most of the traffic you're going to have, most of the on the ground MCON is going to be local traffic, and there may be relays out, but a lot of it's coordination stuff.
I guess what we're talking about is the big picture things are going to be coming out on 75 and 40, but I don't think as much traffic as we think is actually going to end up there anyways.
Yeah.
I don't even know if it's the big picture stuff that's going to go out on those frequencies. The stuff that goes out on those frequencies is probably going to be the calls for help, the calls for material, right, the calls for support, the calls for stuff that they can't get locally.
The phone line's down and we need a place to call sort of thing.
Yeah, the state headquarters, the state capital, I think that's Tallahassee, I think. So that's where their state EOC is, where EOC things are controlled from.
Right.
If they've got communications from there to the affected counties outside of HF amateur radio, they're going to use those.
Okay, Dennis. Thank
but yeah, but that's really, I mean, that's really the question, Marty, is if it crawls along the seaboard for, you know, dozens or hundreds of miles, and you have that devastation over a long, long area, that's the issue.
Right.
Then it's hard for everyone to respond, because the state of Florida, you know, in Tallahassee, they're, you know, so we do we go here? Do we go there? Do we send, you know, some here, some there? That's when it becomes a federal kind of response.
Okay. Let me tell people that we had a Wirecast crash. And
yeah, the video quality went way downhill.
Yeah, I can improve that too. There we go.
Yeah, much better.
Okay. We had a Wirecast crash that took us out of Facebook, and in theory, we're back and back recording and stuff. So I've got technical difficulties with the Ham Radio Now studio system.
You're back. Yeah, you're back on Facebook.
Been trying to fix them for a while, but and I thought I had solved the problems, but apparently not. So we may crash again, or we may go for the rest of the show. So we were talking about state EOC is in Tallahassee. That's the far northwest corner. That's about the one part of the state that is not going to be affected. That's way up here.
That's not Florida anymore.
Interesting.
No, some of that's Florida. Oh, you're down there.
He was in Georgia. Oh,
I see the problem. Okay. There we go. Tallahassee is up here. So they're kind of in the clear. So the question is, with the current state of emergency communications or communication systems outside of ham radio, do they need us for anything? What are the chances are that anybody is going to lose anything? We've been seeing more and more of our need be eroded.
Up in Tallahassee, they probably won't lose anything. But the local EOCs, you know, they may lose communications of power, phone lines, internet, cellular. It's more likely that they're going to lose them. Sorry, that's my phone here. That they're going to lose the connectivity, and that's where potentially, you know, amateur radio would come to help out to get those messages through.
Every couple of years when we get one of these things coming through, the infrastructure has been built up a little more, a little harder. Mm-hmm. The last big hurricane that went through North Carolina about 4 or 5 years ago, the EOC for the eastern third of the state, a regional EOC, had all of their communications outside of ham radio going through one microwave dish on a tower. And that microwave dish got bumped a few degrees. They went
down.
There
you go.
Yeah. I mean, they lost power, yep. But they had their backup power and everything disappeared. And this story was seen on a previous episode of Ham Radio Now. I think it was the one that I kind of recruited you, David, and a couple of other guys to come do the Emcomm Extras. The fellow was, at the time, a fire captain for the Charlotte Fire Department. But he talked about going to that EOC and everything was dark. Not dark. All their communications was out.
Communications-wise, yeah. Right.
And they had sent the ham home some hours before. He said, well, get the ham back.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why.
That guy can talk.
Don't know why no one else thought of that. So we had our big 800 megahertz microwave linked system in place, as we do now, even more extensive, and that something fairly simple took the big Eastern Regional Branch EOC out of communications for a while, far too long. So it can still happen.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, in the Los Angeles area, you know, they're converting. There's a new system that the city's put in place that, you know, it's supposed to be up all the time and reliable. But it's all, you know, it's all based on infrastructure that, you know, do you know it's going to be there or don't you know it's going to be there? And if the power goes down, how long do the batteries last? And does every single hop have that backup? And you know, the assumption is that you know, people that don't understand the technology as well, that it's all going to be there. So we keep training, just like everybody, you know, all the other, probably most of your listeners keep training so that when it comes time to respond, that we'll be there. And it'll be the same thing. They'll have sent us home and we'll probably be in the parking lot drinking coffee and they go looking for us and we'll come in and do our thing.
And I got bad news for everybody. When you're sitting out in the parking lot drinking coffee, nobody's got a handy talkie turned on. And
here's another question.
And the cell phone.
Even if we do, they may not be on the right frequency. So yeah. It doesn't matter.
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing, isn't it?
And how many of these have single points of failure?
How many of what?
All these linked systems, can envision is one coax getting broken, mm-hmm. one antenna, one linking antenna to a hub. Or something failing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, you think about it. You think about that. You know, it's okay. Everything's battery backup and everything's this. But you know, one battery dies or one system's not plugged in the right way. Or you know, we do tests here. So in the LA area, Aries supports hospitals primarily. We have about 66 hospitals in the Los Angeles area that we support. And you know, on a quarterly or biannual basis, the hospitals that I support, they do a power failure test where they flip everything over to the generators. And a lot of times they'll have us come out and join them for that. So just in case something happens, we'll be able to talk to the MAC. That's our kind of our headquarters thing. And every single time they're running through the building facilities, checking every power plug. There's somebody stuck in an elevator because, well, they thought it was on this circuit or they thought it was on that circuit. And, you know, every time they remodel something, it doesn't end up on that circuit. So it's almost impossible unless you have one of these kinds of scenarios where you have a failure to really test, is this stuff going to work? And so everybody's got their fingers crossed. And in the end, again, you know, our group will be there. And, you know, we're expanding the areas that we support beyond the hospitals. But you listen to, oh, we've got the great system and we're rolling it out and it's going to cost millions of dollars. That's great. And, you know, I've got my $1,000 go box and I'll be ready to go. And I've got there's a lot of other people in our organization that will be ready and step up and show up and help out if needed.
Do you? Go ahead, Marty.
This reminds me of the, I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with EAS, the emergency alert system in the world of TV and radio. Mm-hmm. Recently, I think probably in the last month, they had a national test of the system.
2 weeks ago.
2 weeks ago. See, he knows about this stuff. And everybody, you know, there's bugs in these things. One entry point doesn't have their box programmed and A leads to B leads to C. And it seems to be the exact same thing with these drills when you have backups for your backups, but one of but the thing that controls all of them doesn't work, or something like that.
And there will be failures.
There will be it's not if it's when, and and I think the important thing is how well can we handle those whens. There's no avoiding them. It's how do we handle them when they happen.
Absolutely, absolutely. And then it's just showing up to say, how can we help? Not, we told you it'd fail, because that's right. That's another problem too. Because there's a lot of that. You know, you see people. Okay, well, we told you it wasn't going to work out, and now we'll rescue you.
There's a hurricane outside. Let's deal.
Yeah, and that's the thing with you know, our organization. It's really important to show up and say, how can we help?
So there's still a job for us. Mm-hmm. I'm going to say it's going to get less and less over time, because every time one of these things happens and they see what didn't work, then they're going to go fix that and, you know, wait for the next thing that didn't work. I can be pretty sure that the Eastern branch of North Carolina is no longer relying on a single dish pointed from Kinston to Raleigh or whatever for all of their Emcomm. My one period big deployment was to an Eastern county after Hurricane Irene in a rural North Carolina county. And they had all of their Emcomm on a single tower. At the time, it wasn't on the 800 megahertz system. It was on 450 and 150, and that tower fell over. So they had a beautiful EOC. Their EOC was built in what used to be a bank branch. Very nice console and all that stuff, paid for by federal grant money, and all wireline to the transmitters. The transmitters were all still fine. They just had no antennas. So.
And how many redundancies can one realistically have? You know, you can't have 10 coaxes for every one antenna. You can't have, you know, you can't have 10 backups. There's a point where you have to just be prepared to deal with failure.
Yeah. So that's probably why they keep us around.
Right.
Do you guys get good cooperation in your areas between Aries and your various counties and state emergency management? They pay attention to you, or are you shuffled off into the corner and until they need you?
We have really good leadership, all the way up to the section manager. And it takes a lot of time and it takes a lot of effort to, you know, establish those relationships, because it's not about just showing up. It's really about managing those relationships. You know, a lot of the professional responders, you've got to, you know, earn their trust and work to the point where they'll, accept you and see your value. And it's taking, you know, I've only been doing this for about 5 or 6 years. And when I first started, it was different. And they've made a lot of advances where, you know, we've got ties into our local state police, California Highway Patrol. We're working with Los Angeles Police Department in our area. There's a different organization that works with the fire department, but we are, you know, I don't want to say embedded, but we have good relationships, and we're seen as a support resource.
Marty, you're probably
I'm not as qualified to speak on this one.
You're probably too young.
Yes, I
have. Are you 15 yet, or are you still 14?
Be 15 before you know. By the time you finish editing this episode, I'll be 15.
Bad news is I'll be 67. So,
wait, you're what, 33 now? So.
Yeah, yeah. Takes me a while to edit.
Yeah, yeah. It's the rendering time, actually.
So you, but do you get to play Aries?
I do. I've nothing real emergencies, but I do a lot. I've done a lot of the marathons, and I've done the Boston Marathon, which is always an adventure. And you know, they're
what
typically a little bit hesitant to make, you know, a teenager in neck control, but typically they have me doing things like putting out fires and passing messages from, you know, station to station. And, but I have been involved with a little bit of that, but, in general, and I don't disagree. I think it's, you know, there's responsibility in the things we do. We can't, you know, I mean, you can't say, okay, I see my video is frozen, but I'll keep talking. You can't say, okay, one teenager can and one teenager can't. I don't think that's fair. So I think it's, you know, probably for everybody's sake, a good thing that I'm not a lot, or, you know, I can't be doing this stuff, but I help where I can, lot more public service than emergency communications, I'd say.
You'll grow into it. Do they do Boston Marathon as an ICS type thing?
Oh yes. There's the big ICS chart and everything's all broken down, and that has a lot of redundancy, and, you know, I've been involved typically at net control with that for the last year, a couple years. And that's always a big thing, because there's many, many different subnets that are involved with that. And there's lots of interties between all the different organizations and the all the different net controls. There's basically three main net control points. There's a lot of stuff I can't talk about.
there's an old Ham Radio Now show from about the Boston Marathon after the bombing.
I'm good friends with Steve Schwarm. I think I'm pronouncing his last name right.
Yeah, W3EVE. So. Yeah.
And he's a member of my club. Yeah. And I believe you brought him on. He's actually no longer appointed in that position. But he knows his stuff.
And David, I assume you guys do ICS, and can you give us the elevator explanation of what ICS is for the folks who are not familiar with it?
Well, so, you know, the incident command system is, you know, it's a FEMA thing that they put together to really kind of help standardize the response, you know, across the country or across to any incident, you know, at a large enough scale. And we fit into it in our part, and we participate when we can and in that way. And, you know, again, Los Angeles, like, we have a big earthquake every, you know, 10 years or so. We have fires. There's other smaller activities. So we don't get to get out the little vests and play all the time. Not as much as you guys do down there, and definitely not as much as they do in, you know, Tornado Alley. But, you know, some of the stuff that Marty was talking about with the Boston Marathon, we do get to go out and do a lot of public service. And, you know, we kind of work under that umbrella, the public service, you know, our area and a lot of the Southern California area supports the Baker to Vegas race every year. It's the largest police foot chase in the world, where they run from Baker, California to Las Vegas, Nevada, 120 miles or so. And usually they go from no one in the desert to about 50,000 people in a really short period of time. And it's an area where there's no cell phone communication at all. There's nothing. And, you know, we stage out in the middle of Death Valley and, you know, support the racers and support the organization, the race organization. And it's a lot of fun, but it's really good practice. And it really gives us an opportunity to, you know, get all the equipment out, set it up in the middle of nowhere, make sure it all works, you know, practice good radio skills, and, you know, follow along with the program, as it were. And, you know, we do other community service stuff in the LA area as well. And a lot of hams I know do the LA Marathon. There's a 100-mile race, Angeles Crest 100, where a bunch of insane people, you know, over a 24-hour period of time run 100 miles as an individual. And we support that as well. That one's a lot of fun.
I believe that insane. Yeah, in a program I did on the, we were doing ARDF in a local park.
Oh, the championship.
Yeah. And at the same time, there were the guys doing the 100-mile thing. And I think I called them crazy people.
That's fair.
It's a great group of people. I've been supporting that race for 3 or 4 years now. It's a lot of fun. It's, you know, it's a long night where we are at about mile 80 or so. And, you know, people start coming in, and they come out all throughout the night. And it's interesting to see some people just run right through like nothing, and other ones come in, you know, and you worry as they go out to the next stage, are they going to make it or not? And, then we know, again, it's an area where there's no communications, and we're providing good service, and it gives us an opportunity to, again, drag everything out, set it all up, see what we can do, make sure we know everything works okay, and then give us an opportunity afterwards to hot wash to say, hey, this worked, but this didn't, and improve those things.
So you kind of already answered the question I was going to ask. There have been times in the past when ARES leadership said, don't ask us to do these public service bike tours and races and stuff. That's not emergency communications, and we do emergency communications. It always seemed wrongheaded to me that all that stuff was great exercise and practice for real Emcomm. And
didn't the ARRL rename Ares's mission a few years ago to specialize in public service?
I don't know. Did they?
And I think it's part of the mission.
But here's my concern with looking at the public service event, so to speak, as training is think about what goes into planning one of these public service events. We typically, like I know for the Boston Marathon, there's months and months of phone calls and Skype meetings and, you know, signage that's made and procedures and sketches and drawings and, you know, assignments and trainings just for one event. If there's a hurricane tomorrow, we don't have time for that. To me, it almost like gives us a false sense of comfort that we don't have for like when we set up for a public service event, we're testing our planning skills to work everything out to the detail. When there's a hurricane in less than 100 hours, we don't have time for that.
Hmm.
Or if there's an earthquake that happened now, because we don't get any we don't get any warning at all.
You don't get hurricanes out there, do you?
No. We get occasional.
We don't really get earthquakes.
Yeah, we get an occasional big storm and a tornado will touch down, but it's a little tornado in a very small, you know, area, and touchdown will rip a, you know, the roof off a supermarket or, you know, a roof of a house or two, and then it'll go away.
Yeah. So fires and mudslides are the big thing, and then earthquake
and
every
earthquakes.
Once in a while.
Yeah. And, you know, and the other thing too is with Ares, because our mission is primarily hospitals and that's what our MOU is, we get other man-made disasters like, AT&T was cutting a new trench and they cut through the fiber into a hospital, and we'll deploy out to the hospital and, you know, all throughout the building so that they can, you know, have communications between the ER and the pharmacy and the other parts of the building. It's a lot of different missions. It kind of just kind of goes along with what's the customer need. And I know, you know, across the country, all the Ares groups, they have different MOUs, they have different needs. What we do here probably wouldn't work in Tornado Alley. They probably need a whole different set of equipment and response and, you know, numbers of people. It's the same thing with what's going on down, you know, in Florida right now. I'm not prepared for, you know, a foot of water or 2 feet of water or, you know, 100 mile an hour winds for the stuff that I go and take and set up. But I am pretty prepared if there was an earthquake or if there's a fire or heavy rain here. But, you know, heavy rain here in Los Angeles is, you know, a quarter inch an hour or something like that.
Yeah. So, well, Marty was saying that with the public service events, you've got all the time to prepare. The emergencies don't give you that time. Sure. So there is that aspect of them that doesn't really correspond, but it's still the actual event, all the communications, the bike tours and stuff that I do. So it's the one time when you are dealing with a repeater that's got 40 or 50 people on it all wanting to talk at once. And trying to control the chaos.
It's a time to shake all the equipment down. You know, it is an opportunity to get out there, you know, in the middle of nowhere, wherever we happen to do our, you know, our races. It is get it out there, get it set up. It's about the teamwork. It's a lot of it's a camaraderie too. You know, can you rely on these, you know, 10 or 12 other men and women that have been practicing with you to, you know, make the mission happen? Because it will give you a better sense, like when there's a disaster, that you can rely on those people. And, you know, it's hard to hear the primary mission of Ares is to do the support we do, but, you know, it's also take care of yourself, take care of your family. You know, if we have the big one here, first thing I'm doing is, you know, collecting my kids from their schools and coming and checking out my home and making sure that's all good. And if everything's good and everything's fine, then I'm deploying to wherever I might be needed. But if it's not the case, or I can't get to where I need to be, that's not my first priority.
Yeah. And we've heard calls for help from outside of areas because just exactly that, the local hams are taking care of families and infrastructure that's been devastated.
And we're just worn out. Absolutely. And we talk with and have agreements with other, you know, adjoining Ventura County, Orange County, other local areas groups to provide that support. Because like you say, they will have, those people will need to take care of their families, or, you know, after 72 hours, they will be exhausted. And then you can go in and step in and help out. And, you know, that's kind of the point where you talk about, you know, the event that's going on down there. Like, there's a whole list of questions like, can we get in and what do we need to bring? And, you know, what kind of support and what's the mission? You know, what kind of communications do you need to do? All those things kind of come into play in that after action. You know, when the ground shakes, we don't all just get up and go like the fire department does and the police department. We're not first responders. You know, we've got to be asked by our served agencies to come and show up and do the things that we need to do. And it's all after everybody kind of figures out, okay, well, this is what happened and this is where we are. And now we need this kind of help. And you have to put together the team that you can put together.
I also hear a lot about, asking people not to self-deploy, wait until there's a call and then some communication in advance before you show up.
That's absolutely our motto.
Do people ever just show up at your events?
You know, at our events, no, because most of our events, like the races that we go and support, they're in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, but I mean real emergency, the rare ones that actually happen, people just say, "Here, I'm here to help. I'm from Ham Radio, and I'm here to help."
Yeah, I'm sure it happens all the time. You know, it's not been my personal experience because, again, I'm one of those. I don't go to the normal location. You know, I kind of go to that central facility where everybody just can't get to or go. But I know it happens. I know that people definitely show up and you got to corral those kittens and give them something to do to keep them out of the way because, you know, we've trained and we understand the attitude of, you know, we're here to help and we're not in charge and we're just a supplement to whatever else is going on. That's not always the attitude of the guy that shows up with, you know, the truck full of stuff and the whatever.
The big Aries badge and the jacket.
Well,
we all know that person.
Easy now.
I got my big Aries badge here.
But. Yeah. And I've got the reflective vest.
I got that too. But you know, again, it's really about having that attitude of you're here to help. And that works the best.
Yeah. Well, now I've been introducing this program as the Emcomm Extra, something I want to try to do fairly regularly on Ham Radio Now, maybe once a month, and get you guys on to talk about stuff. So we can't do everything. But there's something that I want to ask about before we close things out. And we sort of touched on it a little bit earlier. It is what I will call the vocabulary just left me. We have an embarrassment of riches of spectrum. We have, I'm waiting for Marty to get settled in there before they put the picture back up here. There he goes.
Off your chair there, Marty.
Yeah.
Oh, you can see what I did.
Yeah, when I switched off, he bailed. Hey, he went to get his, there you go. We have an embarrassment of riches in spectrum. And what that means with us being hams is that we don't all agree on what to use. You know, barely can agree on a few repeater frequencies, and we stick with least common denominator FM. One of the things here on the ARL website is the frequencies that are in use. There's that 3950 again. Let's see what those guys are doing.
Thank you, sir. Welcome.
Well, y'all sound good up here in Virginia.
Yeah, I don't think that's Emcomm yet. This is interesting. They call it the Federal Government Amateur Radio Interoperability Frequencies. You recognize what those really are? David, if you're watching the Facebook, you're probably not seeing it yet. But
yeah, I'm not seeing it yet.
Marty, you see these things? Yeah, you know what they are?
They look like 60 meters.
Yeah, it's just 60 meters. But they want to call it the Federal Government Amateur Radio Interoperability Frequencies. So
they're only for Southeast United States.
Well, they're for everywhere, and I don't think they've been used quite very much.
Well, you know, we only get to use those frequencies when they let us, right?
No, we can use them all the time, and we should.
It's 60 meters.
Yeah, it's our 60 meter band, which
was set up
for the with the idea that 80 meters gets in the daytime gets too short, and 40 meters could be too long, and we needed something in between.
Hurricane Matthew Tropical Cyclone Update.
This is the Echolink thing.
National Hurricane Center, Miami, Florida, 10 p.m. Matthew's still producing strong winds over Grand Bahama.
So that's been turned on for the entire program so far, and this is the only thing that we've heard. So they're not real busy either.
Is it top of the hour? So that's kind of what I expect.
Yeah.
Yeah, we do a lot of, so you know, not to get too far off the trail here. I'm a scoutmaster of a Boy Scout troop, and we do a lot of backpacking and wilderness stuff, and I brought a lot of amateur radio to the troop. So, you know, at the top of every hour when you're in the wilderness, you know, you get on the calling frequencies just to see what's going on there and to put out your call and whatever. So I could see on these frequencies, if there's not enough traffic to be going full time, that at least at the top of the hour, they're putting out some kind of status report messaging, you know, hey, we're still here, again, to use those frequencies that we have.
Which I guess is, you know, we were talking about that, the Ragjuan guys, these guys.
Yeah,
just holding the frequency. I mentioned that once to a Skywarn. Mentioned that to a Skywarn EC one time at a big area meeting. That listen to our Skywarn nets when there's not a lot going on. You know, there's not an active tornado on the ground, but there's thunderstorms around, and I was suggesting maybe they could come up with a little bit more, just. Not exactly busy work, but sort of busy work. Check-ins, find out where people are, because they never know where people actually are. And that idea was dismissed as, we don't think that's a good idea. We want to hold the frequency for the emergency call.
So what happens when somebody's radio dies in the middle of that and they're not testing?
Yeah, so we don't do that.
Having done net control for hours at a time, I could see both. I could see both as, you know, one is it's nice to keep it going so that you can hear something's going on, so you know everything's still working. And then on the other side, there's a certain amount of fatigue factor that you run into where you need a rest, and you might want to take a little, you know, 30 minute, you know, close your eyes, but you're still listening for traffic to come up. But you know, you might end up being on the radio for another 8 or whatever hours before you get a good relief.
Yeah. If there's not enough people to handle those jobs. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And sometimes that's the way it goes.
Yeah. But I was just thinking, the biggest thing was they are looking for reports from places, and they'll call and say, is there anybody there, when the weather service asks. But it'd be kind of nice to know in advance and keep the hams out in the field engaged. Because, yeah, they want to know that I'm there. Hams really want to use their radios and be helpful. And
We like the sound of our own voices.
Well. We like to be.
That's broadcasters.
Yeah, that's why I like doing the bike events. It's because it's the most intense ham radio activity outside of a contest.
And they give you the tough jobs too.
So Gary, when you guys do the bike events, what's the protocol for traffic? Is it minimal reports that of, you know, important information, or is there a lot of rag chewing that goes on those nets?
There's no rag chewing. Yeah, no rag chewing.
Okay.
And we've shuffled off as the cell coverage got better and the staff that we work with used texts and stuff. It used to be 90% of the traffic was rest stop 3 needs more cups.
Yeah.
And we
see a lot of that in Boston.
Yeah. We got rid of that traffic. That's for one thing we realized
cause you can handle it on a text message, right? Yeah.
It's very interesting how, I know like for the Boston Marathon, that's like, one thing I know a fair amount about. In the past, it was ambulance requests and medical needs and all of that, and as well as the restocking of the tents. Water station 3 needs more cups. But a lot of that has moved to commercial 800 megahertz stuff, where you know, an EMT in the med tent can be dealing with that, and they don't need that extra body. Where ham radio can be the secondary backup when you know, they break the radios. But a lot of what we've been doing, especially in Boston, and somebody's going to correct me when I get this wrong later. But two things: one is resupply requests. So you know, we need more Band-Aids, we need more latex gloves, we need more cups, we're out of Gatorade, from the medical and water tents. And also on the hour for the Boston Marathon, we give health statistics from the medical tents on the hour to the Department of Health so they can best direct the resources. And that's something you'd think would be done over text. But that's actually one of our big roles, is we collect statistics from each medical tent every hour on the hour. How many people have come in? How many people have been able to continue the race? How many people have had to be transported to a hospital? And, you know, that all uses the ICS structure, and there's lots of paperwork, and then that all goes into digital. It goes to the internet eventually, though.
It does seem like that would be a good use of some sort of data.
And that's what, you know, we do with our mission in LA in activations. You know, we're handling, you know, how many beds does a hospital have open? How many people can they take? What kind of supplies do they need? What kind of, you know, people do they need? What water and so on and so forth. And that's the mission. And you know, 66 hospitals, there's a lot of traffic goes on when we do drills. I haven't been, and it's been some time since we've had a real disaster here that's brought the whole system down. So there isn't a lot of that going on a regular basis. And that's one of the challenges we have. And how do you prepare for that?
Yeah. Do you do any of your traffic on data modes, or is it everything on voice?
Oh, we've been working at it. I've done a lot of FLDigi and beams, and I've done classes for our group. I've done classes for several of our local sheriff's departments, and they're using it a lot more than we are. But we're trying to get there. It's hard because it's you talked about it a little bit before. It's the lowest common denominator when there's a disaster, right? And everybody's going to know how to pick up the radio and push the button, right?
Let me check my calendar. It's 2016.
Yeah.
but how do you push to talk? How does that work?
Yeah. Well, that's the thing, you know, people are traumatized and you have got to get your equipment together. And if you're ready, it's fine. And I'll be ready. And there's a group of us that have been doing some of that traffic and ready to go, but not everybody. And it's hard to get them to adopt. And, oh, do I have a laptop, and how do I power it, and how do I connect it to my radio? And, oh, I got to buy a signal link now and all those other pieces. It's challenging, and we're getting there.
Yeah.
Of course, the person has $2,500 worth of radio gear in their go box, but the $90 signal link is
too much.
Completely.
Yeah. So as
it's a learning curve too.
As I've asked the question about digital stuff over the years, one of the problems I've come up with is, well, a lot of people are interested in digital, but they're all interested in something different, and you can't herd the cats all into the same page.
Yeah. Yeah. We've seen that as well.
Yep. And I was going to ask about the other version of digital that's becoming more and more prominent these days, and that's digital voice.
That was my question.
Yeah. Use any digital voice systems? And if so, which one?
What?
Yeah, we're not doing a lot of that. We're starting to look into Arden, the HamNet broadband and some of those, but we're not at the point where we can deploy it across our area. Again, it's a lot of infrastructure we'd have to support and carry.
Yeah. I've got a show coming up for you guys on Ham WAN, the 5 gigahertz thing that's out in Tulsa, in Memphis, and down in Tampa. And I was down recording the DCC, the Tapper Digital Communications Conference, 2 weeks ago, and spent Sunday afternoon up on top of a tall building in downtown Tampa looking at their 5 gig HamWAN system. You're going to enjoy that.
I know, just to kind of add on to what he said, I know in Boston, we've been doing a lot of our public service events with DMR, just because that's kind of the digital mode of choice.
How did that come to be?
I think it was a lot of, well, we have the gear, and I think it was more out of the heck of it. What is this? The digital radio salute?
Well, that's my new thing I'm learning. This is the DMR handy talkie. Is it even turned on?
You know, we've stayed away from that or D-Star, and there's a lot of D-Star in the Southern California area. The Papa System's a big D-Star linked repeaters from, you know, the border of San Diego, border of Mexico, all the way up to Santa Barbara and beyond. But we've stayed away from it because in that event, you know, again, earthquake, we can't guarantee all those links are there. And if we get reliant on the internet,
there's a lot more to go wrong.
Yeah, there's a lot more to go wrong. Exactly.
Yeah.
It's not that there's anything wrong with it. They're great systems, but, again, we're rolling back to that, you know, minimal approach. If you got to be able to run everything out of the back of your car,
Yeah, I think the one.
Go ahead, Marty.
The one thing that we've used that I personally would agree with you on that one is for the Boston Marathon, we use a lot of interlinking RF and VoIP. Motorola makes a product that's basically emulating a radio with VoIP and bridges for it. And just because we need so many radios, there's so few coax runs in one of our locations, especially, we need probably 30 and there's only two coax runs. So lots and lots of VoIP. And there's some serious reliability issues. And just imagine if
you're not even dealing with a big weather or natural disaster.
No, that's
situation.
That's just normal working. And again, with months and months of planning.
And if you think about it, Marty, how many of the guys in your organization that went to set it up could really do it on their own?
Oh, they can't. And
that's the point.
Right. And a lot of it's there's the one brainchild and then that person gets stuck up in the hospital or,
they get run over by the bus and all the stuff you plan for and all the equipment you
nothing
have.
Nothing works.
Yeah.
Oh, nope.
I saw that two decades ago in the mid 90s when our local EOC, the state EOC is here in Raleigh, and we decided we wanted to try deploying packet. And there weren't that many people that were conversant with packet, and those people were not all that interested in Aries and stuff. So we got it set up based on a couple of key people and kind of went no place because not enough knowledge and interest in making that work. And I was one of the guys that knew how to do it. And I thought, well, this is really cool. It's way better way to send data than Alpha, Charlie, Bravo, 25. But couldn't get enough people interested in doing it. We have the same problem with APRS on our events. The APRS guys don't do events. The event guys don't do APRS.
We've had so much luck with that. That's something new we've been trying for the marathons and a few of the bike events. We've been using it in the sweep vehicles and, dividing each section of the race. Putting APRS in those cars has been absolutely phenomenal for some of the events we've worked on. Everybody's able to position themselves so there's, everybody's evenly divided. And when we've done that and deployed it properly, deploying that, getting maps all set up on monitors with digital receivers, and it's not easy to set up, but once it's set up well, that really plays.
So you must have several packages of deployable.
Right. APRS everybody stations. Has to have a D-Star, an APRS radio, or somebody has to give somebody one.
Yeah. So we just never got enough people that had it.
And it's expensive.
Our radio club put together three packages that could be deployed, but without additional support from individuals, only a few had it. Down at the bike MS that I just did a month ago, we were using Life 360. Sorry.
Life 360
is an Android and I guess Android iOS app for phones that just gets your location and aggregates people and shows you on a Google Map.
How did it work?
It worked okay. There were areas where there was no coverage, but in areas where there was cell coverage, it worked very well. It's designed for that sort of thing.
Very cool.
Okay.
So I have a question to ask. The dreaded question. David, what is in your go box?
What's in my go box? Which go box? So, primarily here the mission is UHF VHF. And I've got a 2 meter, I've got a dual band, I've got a 220 radio, I've got a CB radio, which everybody makes fun of me on. I got a signal link in there and a power supply. And that's the primary one. The secondary one has some HF stuff in it and 2 meter, 70 centimeter radio as well.
Here's another. I know we don't in Boston and New England as much, but do you guys ever use VHF sideband at all? 2 meter or 432 sideband?
We do some single sideband on those frequencies. Mostly we do it for drills or for some of our weekly nets. We have like a weekly net with the Aries group every Monday night here. And then after the primary net we do on a repeater system, we do simplex or we'll do single sideband or we'll go to, whether it's 2 meter simplex or 220 simplex or we'll do FLGG one night a month when we can get people together. So we kind of switch it up.
Do very many people participate in those things, or does your, you know, is it like 2% of the total net ends up doing those
Well, you know, the challenge is because we use a link repeater system in LA, and there's a big mountain that runs, you know, there's like two big mountain ranges that run right through the middle. Right. And so, you know, a third of the people are on one side and then a third are in the middle and another third on the other side. When we go to the simplex nets, it drops down to, you know, a third. And it's primarily because whoever's running the net that night, you can't hear them. And we'll do some relays. But the folks that are, you know, that the folks that are in the city proper, you know, I'm in the San Fernando Valley. The folks that are in the city proper, you know, the Los Angeles City, Santa Monica area, they just know they're not going to hear us, or they're going to only hear one or two stations. And most of them don't stick around for that.
We did a simplex test one time with a local areas group. And it turns out that very few people had outside antennas at home.
So getting into the repeater is fine.
And, yeah.
Yeah. And that's a challenge.
And you know,
it shows up in the simplex test because there will be people that will be, you know, checking in from sitting on their couch, you know, on their HT with, you know, an extended rubber ducky, but it's still, you know,
an extended
it's still an HT, not going to go very far.
They'll only have an antenna.
Yeah, exactly. But, you know, at least they're showing up and they're participating.
I guess if I want to whine a little bit, I'll also whine that if we just try to move from one repeater to another, we're going to lose 25% who don't have that repeater programmed and can't figure it out.
Have you guys done the, okay, well, a repeater A has failed, let's move to repeater B drills?
Exactly.
And C and D?
Yeah. And even if the coverage is similar.
There's nobody left.
Yeah.
When we do deployments, when we do drills, a lot of times we'll start somewhere and then we'll move somewhere else and then maybe move to a third just to see, you know, different frequencies or different repeaters have different coverage just to see how that goes.
Even outside of any kind of Emcomm, just my experience is if you want to move a conversation, especially if it's three or more hams from one frequency to another, the chances of that being successful are small.
Yeah, I think we're pretty good in the LA area. You know, our frequency list is 2 pages long.
That's it?
Yeah. It is small type. We think we have a pretty good time, and we get a lot of folks to actually program in at least the front page into their radios. And so when we say, you know, go to this frequency or go to that frequency, most of the time people show up.
Impressive. So they're trained. They've practiced.
We're trying.
All right. There's something interesting here on this ARL page. David, you'll see it in about a minute, that I had never seen before. FEMA Region 4 in Atlanta will be using the amateur radio call sign KF4EMA. And then there are these, what do they call them? This is not the 60-meter frequencies. These are IARU regional. Okay, here they are. IARU Regional Emergency Center of Activity frequencies. I've never heard of this before. The IARU Region 2 Emergency Center of Activity frequency on 80 meters or 75 meters is 3750. On 40 meters, it's 7060, which is not a phone frequency for folks in the U.S. 20 meters, 14.3, which is kind of right on top of the maritime net. 17 meters, it's 18160, the Global Emergency Center of Activity Frequency.
That's a little bit high in the band. We're 165, right?
168. So you're okay. 15 meters, 21360, and another one on 17 meters. They looked at 17-meter frequency twice.
They 18160. Looked at it twice. Yeah.
Yeah. So I've never heard of these things before.
Yeah, I've never seen anything like that.
Yeah. Nor have I.
It seems like maybe a good idea. I don't know. It somebody's good idea. They got the ARL to publish, but yeah, does anybody use it? I don't know.
It's a million-dollar question.
We'll get comments, you know, email or comments on YouTube or Facebook. Somebody will pipe up.
People have been commenting in the live stream. I know, Gary, you're not set up for
that.
Yeah,
I'm not watching.
Yeah, and I'm not seeing the comments either. I know I saw in the ARIES bulletin today that it said the whole state of Florida was activated for ARIES.
And here they are.
But
I didn't know who you were. That's all. So many come in a while ago at the same
highly
time.
Highly active.
There they are. Well, they could be, you know, on their VHF linked system. They got extensive linking systems going across Florida. But they've got on FM. They've got it on D-Star. They've got it on DMR. Probably getting going on Fusion as well.
Fusion.
Okay, last
confusion.
Last
system
question.
Confusion.
Internet. Does it have a place? You're trying to get me in trouble, Marty, with the system confusion thing.
It's confusion. I'm sorry. It can't. It doesn't work.
I keep meaning to say, you're looking sharp.
So they tried it.
So the internet brought us all together, right, Gary? It's hard to know. I guess it kind of depends on, you know, what's the mission in Emcomm, right? What's the mission? And it all depends on what we're responding to.
Well, I mean, the bottom line is the internet is out of our control and it could go away.
Yep. So I'm not saying 100% rely on it, because I definitely don't.
But it's a tool.
Sure.
We definitely use a lot of IP links in this part of the country, but not internet per se.
Well, I mean, what's carrying them?
It's a microwave.
Yeah, and they do that in South Carolina too.
What do you consider that? They're IP, think like a very long Ethernet cord, basically.
Yeah. Well, if it's on microwave, it's not the public internet.
Right, it's not the public internet. So there's a few more nines of reliability you pick up there.
Yeah, but they don't do that here in North Carolina or most places. But a few places get lucky and get to ride piggyback on a little bit of bandwidth from a state microwave system.
You know, we use the backbone for alerting, right? So, you know, if there's an issue, you know, we send out text and email messages and hope that they get through. And, you know, again, you know, if the ground just stops shaking underneath you, you know, to go and do what you need to do. But you don't always know that happened, because sometimes they're part of your county, but they're not in the part of the county where you are.
Do you guys deploy, not so much for communication, David, but more for kind of dealing with the emergency of the general public FRS or GMRS communications at all?
In the Los Angeles area, the CERT organization that's part of FEMA reports directly to the fire department. They use FRS primarily. And then
as a communication tool or as a monitoring tool?
They use it as a communicating tool, and we'll use it to monitor what's going on. So, you know, CERT works with the fire department to, you know, do the local triage, and they put them on FRS because if they put them on the ham channels, and a lot of those people would be willing to get licenses, then it's too much power and goes too far. And it's great if they're on FRS, then they're three or four blocks, and that kind
of a quarter watt of power.
Puts them where they need to be, and that's a good thing. And there's we can monitor that and provide the support that they need after the fact. And there's groups in LA that are hams that work directly with the fire department, ACS.
Yeah, there's probably nobody in our audience that doesn't know what FRS is, but just in case, it's a UHF short range, unlicensed, half a watt.
Quarter watt.
Half a watt.
Half a watt?
Half a watt. Half a watt ERP.
Half a watt.
Yeah,
right. No removable antenna and all that other stuff.
Antenna's right. Fixed.
You know, basically think a dummy load in the G5RV of VHF.
Well,
I got mine too.
Yeah, if you look at the blister pack, the blister pack will tell you the range is 35 miles.
Yeah.
In a desert.
Half a lot on 460 megahertz.
Salt water in between.
Yeah, not even a desert. I've tried it very flat territory by the beach, and 2 miles was it. And at 2 miles, you were, you know, picking the hot spots. At a half a mile, it was 100% solid. At a mile, you found some dead spots. At 2 miles, a couple of hot spots would do it. So, you know, mountaintop to mountaintop, you could do the 35 miles, but that's just advertising.
Yeah. And there, you know, so the reality is there's a mission for that radio. It's important. And for that door to door search and the, hey, I need local support, it's great and keeps them out of the frequencies that we would need for longer distance coordination. And so it works well. And we listen. And like I said, in my go box, I have a CB radio. And if you think about the whole, you know, the ICX structure that we talked about earlier, in the big disaster where we fall under logistics, part of the mission will be to help bring in material. And a lot of truck drivers, that's what they're on, and they're going to have CBs. And if we have that, we have the capability to provide that service and support to them.
I want to see what Marty's hunting for.
I was looking for my CB, but I found something else that I was.
And, you know, 90% of the time I use that CB, I plug a power horn into it, and we use it for public address.
Oh, yes. That's what is it? The 5 watt. Does anybody know what this is?
I can't. I won't see it for a minute.
Is it a MURS, a MERS?
No, it is not a MERS.
Oh, that's the Vertex radio, right?
Yeah.
Marine?
It's Marine.
Yeah.
So you use that when you're hunting?
No. That does not go with the orange vest.
Oblique reference. A lot of hunters use marine radios. Yeah. They're not supposed to.
I've heard hunters, I'm not sure how many people know a lot about marine VHF, but that's what, 158 megahertz?
Around
there. Yeah. The people will be on channel 16, which is the, you know, the international distress frequency, with the digital selective calling emergency message button depressed. And then they'll be talking about the 5-point buck down the 100 yards away.
Oh, great.
And they did that by accident.
Oh yes. Yeah.
So when I do the bike events, I am often the a shadow for one of the event officials, and we're out in the field, and we'll get to a rest stop, and they go disappear to schmooze and talk to people or go look into some emergency. And as the shadow, my responsibility is to be literally in their shadow and be able to relay messages back and forth to them. So I realized that was a pain in the butt because they kept disappearing on me. So I give them one of these and I carry one of those. And now I can just call them on it. And sometimes that actually works. And this time I realized that what we really need at the rest stop is the what I'm going to call the RSAN, the rest stop area network, where the ham, because there's a ham assigned to the rest stop as well. And he's supposed to be in communication with the rest stop captain and the medic and maybe the guys that do the bike repairs. And they're all spread out across half an acre, and there are a lot of running around trying to get messages through when the messages come in. And the ham has got a handy talkie. He's out of range of the repeater, so he's got to run back to the car to transmit because he doesn't have cross-band repeat set up. So if everybody had one of these, all the key people, no more running around.
What if they could then, how much of the traffic that you hear on the ham net would be helpful for your person who you're shadowing to know?
Well, that's all helpful. That's one of the main reasons for keeping David ham radio around.
No. I don't know.
Well, but we consider the open network valuable because when someone is talking about something, we may have an idea about that. That now we know we can forward. Yeah,
that part's true. If they're overhearing and they say, "Oh yeah, I know the answer to that question."
Yeah,
but I think ordinarily they don't want to hear all the traffic going on.
They want to hear what's relevant to them.
Yeah,
The folks that I'm working with, they love it. They eat it up. But they also it ends up being somewhat of a distraction, and so I'm listening to it, and they're going doing something else, talking about something else.
Yeah, and I think that's the biggest problem.
Do you ever give them a ham rig?
We gave a doctor a ham rig who was on the course, and he's been getting a handy talkie to listen to for about 5 years. This year he showed up with a ham license.
Ooh.
Yeah.
That's good.
That was pretty cool. We give receivers or handy talkies, you know, just for receiving to the supply truck guys. Yeah. Keep up with what's going on. But if they got to talk back, call on the phone. Yeah, that's exactly it. So I think we've exhausted about everything that we need to for this episode of Ham Radio Now, this Emcomm Extra number one. As you can see, there's an endless supply of stuff to talk about. But I'm just kind of taking advantage of this hurricane that's coming in to get this off the ground because it was taking me forever.
And I got this was nicely timed.
I got a couple of other guys that have been interested in helping out as well. And Marty, you just showed up. You texted me on Facebook or something. And I said, hey, you want to be on the show?
My camera's not working.
Yeah, want to be on the show? And so here you are. So I appreciate your stopping by. Let me do the fundraising. Arvin is sitting back there saying, you didn't say anything about us at the opening of the show. And that's because I forgot. But also because the only people that really care about contributing to Ham Radio Now and keeping all this stuff going are the folks here at the end of the show. So hamradionow.tv, and that's all I need to say about that. So you guys, let's wrap this up. Marty, tell everybody who you are, what you do, and where to find you.
I am Marty, KC1CWF. If you want to learn more about me, check out chickenwithfries.com. That's where you will find my email, contact information, stupid bios, pictures, all that stuff. Yeah.
And you're on every social media and every other show.
You the latter is true.
Absolutely the media gadfly of ham radio. And David, you've been heretofore anonymous.
Yeah, pretty much.
Now you're not anymore. So
yeah.
Give me a little.
And I hope I'm not in trouble, but that's all good.
Everybody who shows up in this show gets in trouble sooner or later. So
I've been in trouble.
If it didn't happen this time, it'll happen sooner or later. Do you want to give any bio besides your Aries activity?
So David Goldenberg, you can follow me on Twitter at W0DHG. That's my call sign. I'm an EC with Aries and Scoutmaster with Boy Scout Troop in the Los Angeles area.
All right. So the hurricane is now battering the west coast or east coast of Florida, and wish those guys good luck. I am trying to get down to the beach to go on vacation. We're going to be at least a day late, maybe two. And I am going to attempt to get down into maybe South Carolina, the Charleston area. We'll see how things go down there and tote a camera with me and talk to some folks in the aftermath, because that's when our activity really happens. If communications get wiped out, that's when it happens. During the hurricane, yep. As it's going over, we duck our heads and hunker down like everybody else. We podcast. Well, I'm out of the affected area, as they say, at least for the time being. So thank you, guys. Appreciate it very much. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. The website is hamradionow.tv. And I know you know how to do this, Marty, David. I'm not sure if you've gotten all the way to the end of any Ham Radio Now shows, all the way to the bitter end before the logo comes in, kaboom.
I'm sure I have, but I don't know what the answer to this question is.
It involves bad radio procedure.
It's fine radio procedure.
It is Hollywood radio procedure. And I'm seeing it more and more.
Over and out?
That is it. We'll split this up. Marty, you get the over. David, you get the and I'll take the out. Marty, you're on.
Over.
And.
Out. Good night, everybody.
Good night, guys.
Good night.
It didn't crash anymore. Yay.
Where's the pretty sound in the...
Oh, that doesn't happen until I do post.
That's post-production, right? Yeah.
Goodbye, Facebook.
All right, this is great.
Goodbye, Facebook.
When are you going to get lower thirds and whatnot?